photographer Bruce King talks with producer Ben Bagley about his days on Broadway. Also coming up, a nostalgic look at the off-Broadway musical hit, Boy Meets Boy.
Olden days, the place of something was the sound of something shouting now. Heaven knows, anything goes. Good authors too, who once knew better words, now only use four-letter words, writing when most guys who say that women try to say are just silly gigolo. So though I'm not a great romancer, I know that I'm bound to answer when you propose. Anything goes.
I would like to start out this evening by thanking those of you who bought tickets for the opening night of Sebastian and our first anniversary party, which we held last week at Ozma. Regardless, of course, as to whether or not you loved the film, thank you again for attending. 2 weeks from tonight, Neil Kennedy, who played Max in the film, will appear in this program. Neil was the aggressive Christian hater who shot the final arrow into Sebastian. Vito Russo will be talking with Neil. Next week on the Emerald City, we'll be featuring the first TV interview ever done in this country with Tom Robinson, the controversial rock star currently has the number one record in England. The clincher is that Tom is presently king of teeny bop over there, and at the same time is openly gay. Tonight on the program, Bruce King, who is a photographer of celebrated faces, and also he's the editor of Gay Scene, he'll be talking with Ben Bagley. In the 50s and 60s, Ben was famous for his shoestring reviews. He is also credited with having launched a very impressive list of stars in the show business. He's a recognized authority on nostalgia and also a record producer. I think you'll find him very interesting. As I've mentioned many times before, this month is the first anniversary of this show. We're not going to pull out a giant roll call for the year, but we are going to show you a little bit of the very first thing we ever shot on for the program, which was Boy Meets Boy. We shot it back in July of 76, long before this program ever became a reality. So in case you missed it then, I'm sure you're going to like it now. We'll pause and be right back with Ben Bagley. Don't go away.
Ice Collar 57, a new age in disco. Ice Collar 57. The total nocturnal experience, the best location, the brightest room, and the most beautiful people. Ice Palace 57. No membership required. Hard to believe, but true.
Good memories with good music. You'll find it all at Happy Tunes. Happy Tunes, 53 West 8th Street in the Village. You may find it difficult locating Jan Wallman, but the best things in life aren't always easy to find. Jan Wallman, 28 Cornelia Street, where 6th Avenue meets West 4th. Jan Wallman, fine food in a fine setting.
Lines, 24-hour live answering service. Rates are from $5 monthly. Friendly, efficient Metro Lines.
One day was like the other. I never saw a thing. I ago. I thought it was the same thing, and now I think I understand the whole darn blame thing. Life was monotonous, life was wet. Life could have gotten us if we hadn't met and discovered we were meant for us.
Good evening, I'm Bruce King. This evening I have a guest for you that is responsible for the Shoestring Reviews, the Cole Porter Reviews, and 24 albums of revisited famous composers. And these are songs that have been lost or been deleted. Ben Bagley, what is a lost song?
Oh, it's a song. My albums are Bodge and Hodge with Gershwin and Cole Porter. They're little known songs, and they were often the showstoppers in the Broadway musicals of the past, things that B. Lilly did and Ethel Merman that never became hits. But they're charming, and as the Times said this Sunday, well worth exciting and well worth listening to.
Now, what's the latest?
A rave review on
what's the latest one
these
that
are
you
mine
have?
Too. I have two Rugs and Hard Hounds with Anthony Perkins, Lynn Redgrave, Estelle Parsons, Blossom Deary, Johnny Desmond. They're my two new releases. They're Rugs and Hard albums.
Now, who buys these albums?
All very superior people. Not the sort of people that buy Donna Summer Records or Donnie and Marie, but really superior people, the master builders of this country, the future greats. Superior people.
Now, how did you get started on these albums?
Well, it's a long story. Do you want to hear this whole story?
Well, briefly, your record company is called Painted Smiles.
It's called Painted Smiles. Well, I figure that anybody over 40 is, that's about all they've got left is a Painted Smile. It's so difficult, Bruce, to get through life and reach 40. You should get a medal by the time you reach 45, I think. And it is very tough. And working in show business with all these unpleasant people, you know, in the Shoestring Reviews, I discovered B. Arthur and Cheetah Rivera, and I worked with Kay Bowden and Nicole Porter Show. And you work with a couple of twats like this, and it's very exhausting. Mm-hmm. By the time you're 40, about all you can do is paint on a smile. And
well,
that's what Painted Smiles refers to.
Well, now, in 1955, you did a Shoestring Review, and then you did one following that called The Littlest Review.
With Tammy Grimes, yeah. Discovered Tammy Grimes and Joe Gray.
And then you did a final one, a Shoestring 57.
That's right.
And
I fired Carol Burnett from that.
You fired Carol from
that.
Yeah.
Because Bruce, you were my photographer.
Yeah. And then you did the Cole Porter Decline and Fall, which you can give the complete title to.
Decline and Fall, The Entire World Seems to Be Isaac Cole Porter with Kay Ballard and Harold Lang. That was with that was based on my Cole Porter Revisited album, which is the second album I made.
And then you did
it's opening tonight at Theater Memphis. Memphis,
yes. And then you did a second Cole Porter review.
Oh, with Bobby Short and Dodie Goodman, Danny Meehan, and some beautiful girls, Virginia Beth Goss and Jane Manning. You photographed that one?
Yes, I did them all, yeah. And then you started somewhere in the early 60s.
Well, I started doing
with the album.
With the record. Yeah, 1960 I did the first Rodgers and Hart. This is volume 3 and volume 4 that I've got now. And started recording the unknown songs and musical comedies of these people. And I did the first for a subsidiary of RCA Victor. And that was successful, Rodgers and Hart volume 1. Then I went to Columbia, and I did Cole Porter, Jerome Kern, and then I did Gershwin, Noel Coward, and Irving Berlin for MGM. And then at the Cole Porter Show, I met a very strange man. He was very old, and he looked like a bum. His shirt was all dirty and frayed, and he was standing on a table at the club taking pictures of the show with a flashbulb, and I told him to get down, and that he had no business taking pictures during the performance because it was distracting the performers. And he said, well, I can take pictures up here because I'm a friend of Ben Bagley's. And I said, I am Ben Bagley, and I took his camera away. Turned out this man, who was just like a bum, was worth $80 million, Jerome Hill. His father built the Great Northern Pacific Railroad. So Hill loved my albums, and he formed Painted Smiles with me. And 2 years later, he died, and I inherited the company, and I've been doing revisitings ever since.
Now,
At 24 now.
Now, after you started Painted Smiles, you went about gathering up the master tapes from the various companies.
I bought everything back.
And
yes.
I think the story about writing to the man at Columbia about the children, I think that's an interesting
Well, that was Goddard Lieberman.
Oh, well, tell that.
Well, it's awfully hard to get things out of Columbia. Once you've done something for Columbia Records, they try and hang on to things for years and years because they keep reissuing. Album.
Yeah.
And so I called him up and I said, these are my children and I want them back. And for some reason, I don't know why, I said, I have no children. I guess that touched him. I don't want children. I want cats. I mean, cats
are Fogarty.
Fogarty, oh, he's beautiful. He's a charming cat. And then before that, I had Butch. He said,
yeah,
little sound. Yeah. But he gave me back everything, all my master tapes. He was touched by the fact that I had no children and these are my children. A lot of bullshit.
Mm.
But sometimes bullshit works.
Now, some of the people that have appeared that are sort of unlikely people that would have appeared on albums.
Well, I guess Anthony Perkins, I think that you heard him singing in the beginning. He's doing a song which was cut out of By Jupiter before it even opened, Rodgers and Hart Musical, and he's singing a song with a chorus of four men, and they're all singing about how great it is being in love with each other. I do very, because on the same record, I have Blossom Dearie singing a love song with girls.
And then you have Lynn Redgrave.
And Lynn Redgrave, is on the albums, and Estelle Parsons. And I love making the records because you get with these actors and these singers, and we make several tapes, and then they go home, and you say goodbye to them, which is what I like to do, because I don't like to be terribly friendly with actors. They're very dangerous. And then I edit it all down and take the best notes and the best things together, and then the album comes out. They're always delighted. And what is tough is working in the theater and working with someone like Kay Ballard for 15 months, if you have a hit, is very draining. It's tiring.
Mm-hmm.
So the albums are profitable and fun to do, and I don't have to become involved with theater people.
Mm-hmm.
I can go home at night to Queens and meet my own friends and decent people.
Now
see, I'm not a theatrical type. I come from Hardwick, Vermont. I was a farm boy in Vermont, and came to New York City.
Came to the big city.
Yeah.
And at the age of 21, you were the youngest producer, I suppose.
That's right,
that's very
important to remember.
On Broadway.
That's right, because that was Shoestring Review in 1955. Now when I meet people like B. Arthur and Cheetah Rivera, and their faces are fallen and everything, and they look old, and they say, my God, it's a great plastic surgery. And, you know, B. was 37 in 1955, and I was 21, and Cheetah was 34 or something like that. And they need new paint jobs, these ladies, and they think that I've had surgery. They don't believe it when I tell them that I'm 44. But you have a good memory, Lindsay.
Well, you have a lot of people that you helped along the way, such as Dodie Goodman and Joel Gray, Tammy Grimes.
Yeah, and a lot of writers, Sheldon Harnett, Mike Stewart, Tom Jones, Harvey Schmidt, and Harvey does my album cover. He's representing the Museum of Modern Art, besides being the composer of the Fantastic.
Yeah.
You know, and Hunter Dunn
the Shade. Yeah.
I would say that of all the people that I've worked with, the only, and discovered really, like Norman Lear in The Times, when he was interviewed, he said that he found B. Arthur and Dodie Goodman and Ben Bagley, Shoestring Review in 1955, and never forgot them, and was waiting till the opportunity ready to present them on television. And these people really owe me their careers. But when you talk to them about, you know, coming through with some help or some money or something to back something, you know, future work or albums or things, they don't know you anymore.
Yeah.
Very ungrateful. Except for Harvey Schmidt. Harvey has never forgotten that I gave him the start.
And you also told me an interesting little story about how charming Johnny Desmond was when he opened the
You
were up and...
Johnny Desmond is a fine person, but he's with the... I don't think we can talk about what we were talking about.
All right, but I just thought the idea of him asking you about the residual and...
Yes, that's what we're talking about. Well, that's interesting. He was concerned that his check for singing all these songs might be too high. And he said, well, that's an awful lot of money, Ben. He said, why don't you knock off a couple of $100? I was writing out the check, so I did that. I mean, but he's a very unusual person. He's Italian, for one thing, and Italian people are very much into artistic ventures and art. Hart.
Well, I photographed Desmond. I found him a very charming,
nice,
very
there
delightful
are
person.
Some people that are very regular and down to earth. But mainly, when my ma was dying, 1960, I visited her in the hospital, and she said, "Promise me, when you get back to New York City, you'll go into another business." And I said, "Why?" And she said, "Because I don't want to die thinking of you having to work with the human garbage in the theater." And that's basically why I gave up doing the reviews and looking to discover new talent, and why I went into the records.
Well, I think that's all very good, and I hope it will lead into you doing something, another review, because I think the public is ready for it.
Well, possibly,
and
but it's very tiring.
Well, but I think you have a lot of energy.
In the theater.
Yeah. I think you have a lot of energy. And
well,
I think
I'm sticking with the records. They're doing quite well. It's amazing. Their sales are going up and up and up each year, and I think that's because we're getting back to beauty. And also, it's an indication that there are more superior people than there used to be.
Mm-hmm.
I think rock is sort of fading out, and to some extent,
disco
stuff.
I think you're serving a definite purpose here and bringing something different to the public and something that's unusual
and spicy
and so on. Incidentally, his liner notes are often worth just the price of the album.
Well, Rex Reed said he wonders how I can get them through the mail. But it's the way I really feel about things, and sometimes people think they're a little libelous, but they're not. I mean, you're entitled to your own opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Rex quoted in his review in the Daily News what I'd said about Liza Minnelli, that no matter what they did with her, she looked like she'd taken a strong whiff of Carol Burnett's breath. But, I mean, that's my opinion.
Yeah.
It's not Liza. And
well,
God, she's boring.
I think that's all very interesting, and we seem to be running out of time, so I think we've had a very interesting little visit with Ben Bagley.
Well, he's alienated almost everybody in New York City. I always like to do that.
Thank you very much, Ben, and good evening.
Dayton is the second oldest daily newspaper in the country, with news and reviews on the world of theater, film, and books. Subscription is $8 a year. Wright Regiment, Box 247, Grand Central Station, New York, New York, 10017. Check out the Dayton today.
Men who walk on the wild side. In Mandate, you'll meet the bad and the beautiful, the high and the mighty, the punky, the hunky, the very grand funky, the butch and the brawny. In Mandate, there are reviews, interviews, the manly, the macho, the much too much. Monthly, in Mandate, the best-selling magazine of its kind in the world for men who walk on the wild side. Mandate.
Come to Man's Country. See what we're all about and what we have to offer. Man's Country is a full facility, multi-leveled complex that was designed to feature something for everyone. Come to Man's Country and develop your body or a friendship with somebody else's. Visit us once and you'll come again and again. For the best workout in town, it's Man's Country, 28 West 15th Street.
Paradise.
Timbuktu. I can't say enough about it. I've definitely come to you 1,000 times over. It was a great
thrill
to see it.
Superb.
And I just love the show totally.
Her
show is superb.
Welcome to Timbuktu. Last week before national tour, New York engagement ends September 10th. Call now, 239-7177.
Twilight, New York's only true international cruise bar with unbeatable service and grace. At Twilight, people don't just stand around and pose. They talk, meet, and react. Visit Twilight tonight.
If you're interested in where to buy, what to find, and how to pay, spend your money gay. Pick up a copy of the Gay Yellow Pages and shop around.
One day was like the other. I never saw a thing. I played ball with my brother. I heard my sister sing.